and thank you for joining us today for Grace Nono's lecture. And thank you to Tracy for our wonderful Philippine lunch. It's our first one, and it tastes so good and set a wonderful spirit for today's lecture. After today's lecture, we will have one more lecture in the Women's Studies and Religion program this semester, and that will be on Thursday, December 3rd, also here at noon with lunch. And that will be Susanna Drake's lecture, Veils and Revelations, Gender and Allegory in Early Christianity. So we look forward to that and hope you'll be able to join us. But today we're really excited to welcome Grace Nono, who's one of this year's research associates in the Women's Studies and Religion program across the street. We're having a wonderful year together in the house, working very intensely, and we have kind of a focus on the arts, and Grace has brought her voice to that conversation. She is, as well as a scholar and ethnomusicologist, she is also a performing artist in the Philippines and the Philippine diaspora. In both arenas, both as a performer and as a scholar, she works with the traditional indigenous Philippine shamans and their healing chants. And she's really crossed over these two roles. She goes back and forth. She's served as a faculty in the Art Studies Department at the University of the Philippines at Diliman, and she's also served as head of two nonprofit organizations, the Tao Foundation for Culture and Arts and the Artists Welfare Project. As a singer, she specializes in the music that she also studies. I think of that as performed scholarship, that she's really learning through performing about the indigenous sacred chants and traditional themes. She has published two award-winning books, both about the indigenous shamans of the Philippines, The Song of the Babaylon, Living Voices, Medicines, Spiritualities of Philippine Ritualist Oralist Healers, which won the Glingtong Aklat Award in 2014, and also the Catholic Book Award. And she, this year, she's working on her third book in this area, which is part of what she will be talking to us about today. Thank you, Grace.
Thank you, Anne. I'm going to stand on this because the podium is almost as tall as I am. Maing udto kaninyong tanan, nalipay ako nga nakaabot kamo. Bisan tugnaw in taon ang panahon niya nag-uwan-uwan sa sagawas. My name is Grace Nono. I'm the daughter of Ramona, who's from northern Mindanao. Camiguin is the name of the island. It's the island of seven volcanoes. And my father is from central Luzon in the north. So I am the daughter of two ethnolinguistic groups from the south, from Mindanao, and from Luzon in the north. Much of my writing to date has been to intervene in claims by a number of early Spanish and American colonial administrators and missionaries of the elimination of the predominantly female Philippine babaylan, or ritualist oralist healers, very roughly translated as shamans, who, by resisting and leading revolts against colonial and missionary encroachments, were maligned as evil and idolatrous, were hunted down, some of them even fed to crocodiles. I'm sorry to ruin your appetite. I hope I don't. In addition, my work has attempted to intervene in claims, mostly by Philippine historians of the Babaylan's obsolescence in the modern nation, thus warranting the Babaylan's absence and erasure in both official and alternative history narratives since the 20th century. Finally, my work has been to intervene in idealized and homogenized representations by a number of Philippine nationalist, feminist, and decolonization scholars of the Babaylan as a historical spirit and symbol of woman power and gender equality that must now be embodied and invoiced by the Philippine intellectual elite, but in so doing also erase the Babaylan all over again. Realizing the disconnect between these erasures, malignments, elisions, and idealizations of the Babaylan on the one hand, and my own face-to-face engagements with living Babaylan since the late 1980s on the other, I have sought to write about living, historical, predominantly female Babaylans who survived colonization, whose vocations continue to be relevant to many of our people, but whose current conditions are far from ideal after these Babaylans lost much of their status to the predominantly male clergy of Christianity and Islam, to doctors of modern westernized medicine, and to leaders of institutions inaugurated during the centuries of colonization. Despite their loss of status, however, these Babaylans' embodied voices in speech and song have every now and then disrupted the Babaylans' imposed silence without necessarily always framing such disruption as resistance, and have intervened in more dominant ways of being in the world. I must tell you at this point that in the same way that the universalization of the term shaman, originally referring to the priest healer of Siberia's northern steppes, had probably less to do with the shamans themselves than with globalizing European modernity, according to Thomas Carl Alberts, so has the term Babaylan gained national and even transnational prominence, not because of the Babaylans themselves, but because of nationalist, feminist, and decolonization scholarship and social movements since the 1980s. The term Babaylan originally refers to the ritualist, oralist healers in many places in the Visayas or Western Philippines, but there are many other titles accorded to such functionaries across the Philippine Islands. My presentation today draws on one of the chapters of my current project with the Women's Studies in Religion program. It inquires into the Agusan Manobo term, yagong, roughly translated in English as embodied voice, of a particular Babaylan named Undin Potenciano. Actually, she is referred to as Baylan, not Babaylan. Baylan is the term for Babaylan in the Agusan, among the Agusan Manobo people. Baylan Undin specializes in many different healing modalities, most important of which is ritual. Baylan Undin lives, So that is the Philippine, the Southeast Asian map, it's the Philippines. And so Mindanao, Luzon is over there, the central islands in the middle, and Mindanao over here. So Babaylan originated from the central islands, but it has become popularized, the term, and is now being used to refer to Babaylans all over the country, but really there are many, many different names and differences also in the practices of the different functionaries. This is Agusan del Sur, where Baylan Undin comes from, in La Paz. That is where the term is Spanish. I will say more about the colonial period later. And I'm actually from Bunawan, but to go to La Paz, you have to go all the way to Prosperidad at the top, and then come down through San Luis to La Paz. So it's a long travel, maybe more than half a day. Baylan Undin lives in a hinterland area in La Paz, Agusan del Sur, northeastern Mindanao. Southern Philippines. a place reachable only by foot or by single motorcycle or by water barge. La Paz and its surrounding areas are part and parcel of the ancestral domain of the indigenous Agusan Manobo people. It is an area that for decades was the site of much pillage and plunder of its forests by transnational logging companies in cahoots with the late dictator's cronies. It is also the site of much government neglect, which engenders and aggravates armed conflict between communist insurgents and the government military. Up to now, there's a lot of bloodshed going on. Finally, La Paz has been the site of aggressive proselytization since the late 16th century, first by the Jesuits and Recollect Augustinian orders, and in the last century by at least a dozen Protestant denominations, many of them unfortunately committed to putting an end to indigenous spiritual practices like those practiced by Lan Undin. Unlike many Manobos who have moved to lowland settlements first set up by the Spanish to control native populations who have become Christianized and trained in the westernized educational system, Undin has remained in the hinterlands that by now bear the deep marks of capitalist-driven logging, communist armed struggle, and Christian missionization, but where she has had relatively greater freedom to pursue her vocation as a ritualist oralist healer under the direction of spirit sources. Undin's formation as a bailan began with a long bout with illness years after the passing of her grandmother, who was herself a renowned bailan during her time. Undin became healed of her undiagnosed illness only when she began to serve as a bailan, that is, when the soul of her bailan grandmother and other spirit helpers began to descend upon her to act as her abiyan, or spirit guides and helpers during healing ceremonies, childbirth, and other observances in which Undin's yagong, or roughly translated as embodied voice, sang the song of the abiyan, or spirit. Today, I will talk about Bailan Undin's yagong, the distinctive sound of her somatic and material self, her embodied voice that is physically tangible to her listeners. I am particularly interested in how this yagong is generated, how it is listened to by Undin's ritual participants, what this yagong tells us about the bailan and the abiyan, or spirit helpers, and finally, how this yagong relates with dominant understandings of voice. In particular, I would like to put Bailan Undin's experience of yagong in conversation with a notion of voice that has quite a long history in the West, that of voice arising from an individual material source, a body like no other. This view had been asserted since antiquity by the likes of Roman rhetorician Quintilian, who wrote that every human being possesses a distinctive voice of his own. Roland Barthes, who wrote of the voice as something which is directly the cantor's cavities, muscles, membranes, and cartilages. Adriana Cavarero, who posited the voice is always different from all other voices, even if the words are the same. Mladen Dollar, who argued one way to be aware of the voice is through its individuality. We can almost unfailingly identify a person by the voice, the particular timbre, resonance, pitch, cadence, melody, the peculiar way of pronouncing certain sounds. The voice is like a fingerprint, instantly recognizable and identifiable, says Dollar. Some complications have been offered of these views by scholars also located in the West, historicizing European conceptions of the body. Stephen Connor wrote that in the late classical and medieval periods, the body was conceived not so much as an object or the home and expression of personality as a dynamism. Conceived in this way, the human body was seen as vulnerable to invasion by other forces and agencies. The insides and the outsides of things are not so powerfully distinguished as they are in later conceptions. Insides and outsides change places and produce each other reciprocally. But during the 17th and 18th centuries, such conceptions of the body as porous and permeable began to be steadily eroded, wrote Connor, replaced by the notion of the body as an object in a coherent and fixed field, an individual unity by itself. Such view of the body and consequently of the voice was in turn introduced by forces of colonization, missionization, and modernity to indigenous peoples in different parts of the world. This meant that indigenous peoples now had to rid their bodies and their voices of the comings and goings of ancestors, deities, and spirits in general, to restore their agencies to their own individual selves, and to facilitate the missionary project's revelation of what the colonizers, both Christian and Islam and Muslim, deemed to be the superior Godhead. Keeping in mind the foregoing discussions, I posit that the permeability and what I refer to as the relationality of both the body and the voice that was and continues to be suppressed by neo-colonial regimes remains in place and for valid reasons, including the healing of illnesses. The relational voice that arises not from individual materiality but from plural and overlapping materialities continues to be heard as we speak in ways that does not annul the individual agent but maintain her critical participation in composite acts of voicing. This was demonstrated by Bailan Undin Siagong, or embodied voice, in its performance of the Good Good. Good Good is the spirit's song during a panumanan, or ritual, for the purpose of healing, as witnessed and participated in by Undine's fellow Agusan Manobo. The panumanan, or ritual, that I will speak of took place in November 2005 in Undine's brother's house in La Paz, Agusan del Sur. The panumanan was officiated by Bailan Undin and was participated in by her nephew, Saison, a young man who at that point could barely walk or move his arms. Also present were young Manobo woman leader, Robilin, and her mother, Ibing, their friend, Lita, my research guides, Manobo Free Methodist pastors and Bible translators for the Summer Institute of Linguistics, Florencia and Jose Havana, my mother, Ramona, and myself. That Pastor Jose was a former Bailan proved most helpful in interpreting the Good Good's sonic cues. Good Good is the spirit's song. And the spirit's archaic language that escaped even indigenous Manobo ears. Some words of caution. It will be easy enough to locate the Bailan's spirit helpers, the Abyan, in a pantheon not their own. And in so doing, distort Bailan experience. Vicente Rafael had something to say about this. He wrote, in reorganizing the structure of native beliefs, Spanish Agustinian priest Tomas Ortiz in 1731 followed the standard missionary hierarchizing impulse that situates these spirits at the top of a spiritual order, then positions this order as part of a set of reflections of a distant pre-Christian past. Furthermore, missionaries equated the natives' ritual offerings or signs of respect to these spirits with idolatry, thus conflating the nature of the natives' offerings with those of Christians. To Raphael's clarification, I add Karen McCarthy Brown's description of another group of spirits, Haitian spirits, whose qualities, by her description, may be related with those of the Abyan or the Bailans. Spirit helpers. According to Brown, Haitian spirits referred to as saints are not necessarily saintly types in the traditional Christian sense. They are not always models of the well-lived life. Rather, they mirror the full range of possibilities inherent in the particular slice of life over which they preside. Failure to understand this has led observers to portray these spirits as demonic. Brown further noted that virtue for these spirits and those who serve them is less an inherent character trait than a dynamic state of being that demands ongoing attention and care. Virtue is achieved by maintaining responsible relationships characterized by appropriate gifts of tangibles like food, shelter, and money, and intangibles like respect, deference, and love. When things go as they should, these gifts flow in continuous interconnected circles among the living and the spirits of ancestors. To this, I add from Philippine experience that when such relationships are disrespected or disrupted, illness could potentially result, illness which can be healed through the restoration of good relationships with the intervention of the Bailan and her guiding spirits. Now I will talk about Bailan Undin Siagong, or embodied voice, in the context of Panumanan, or ritual. The Panumanan commenced as soon as nightfall descended on the hut by the hill where we were gathered, and the surroundings were abuzz with cicada songs. It was a cool late October evening in Barangay Panagangan in La Paz. Bailan Undin carefully laid out betel nut preparations on a white porcelain plate beside a glass of fermented coconut juice and ornaments made from red, yellow, white, and black glass beads strung together with tinkling brass bells, all of which were dedicated to Undin's abyan, or spirit guides and helpers. Undin began the Panumanan ritual with a panawag tawag, a recited invocation delivered by her in a half-whispering tone. This was followed by a wordless melismatic passage by what I heard as her mild-mannered and medium-register yagong, or embodied voice. She then launched into a tud-um, or song in the Manobo language, as she paid respects to the spirit dwellers of the area and prayed to Magbabadya, or creator, for protection. A minute or so later, my research guide, ex-Bailan, now Pastor Jose Havana, pointed out what he and the other Panumanan participants were noticing as a subtly perceptible change in Undin's yagong, or voice. I myself began to hear Undin's breath tremble and her yagong taking on a louder, harsher, and brighter tone that was also swifter in shelling out words. Jose whispered to me at that point that Undin's yagong had crossed over from singing the tud-um, or song, by her own voice alone to good-good, or the voice of the abyan, or spirit, singing through her. One of the elders present told me that the name of the abyan that had just descended was Oknabanon, the owner of Undin's tud-um. Oknabanon resided in the mountain forests and was invited only when there were important issues to be resolved requiring spirit intervention. In archaic Agusan Manobo, Oknabanon introduced himself. If only the name were clear, this is Oknabanon. The nickname is Ojambuan, a man who will never grow up, an eternal child. Oknabanon proceeded to ask the ritual participants, "People, what difficulty do you want me to address? For it is troublesome to be asked to do something." Oknabanon continued to sing, this time about the ritual participants, including myself, whom he referred to as someone who came from the east, where the sun rises from beyond the sea. Soon after, Undin paused, breathing heavily. She did a melismatic wordless passage again, then picked up on the good-good, or the spirit song, this time in what seemed to be a slower, lower register and heavier yagong, or voice, and a tune that was different from what she had been singing just a few seconds ago. One of the elders present told me that Mikdong, literally old person, that is the name of Undin's departed grandmother, a famous Bailan during her time, had taken over. Addressing Oknabanon, the first abyan, Mikdong sang, translated to English by Jose. "All right. Even so, even if it's troublesome to be asked to do something, you should be here anyway." Mikdong also rebuked one of the ritual participants, young Man Saison, Undin's nephew who was ailing at that time, but who had been mocking the Panumanan since it began because he no longer believed in such tradition. Saison also ridiculed his own father for having an abyan, or spirit guide. Following Mikdong, Oknabanon reiterated his question, What happened? Sing your song louder. Is your story just a game that is lacking in substance because nothing serious had been presented so far? And Oknabanan was only invited when there were real problems to be solved. McDong again took over, addressing Oknabanan. Even if you say that it is just a game, it is still important. Whatever concern our medium has, referring to Undine, we must discuss it. Just follow the plan and agree. Oknabanan raised another point. The song, the word comes not from Undine's house. For us to sing in a house not our own makes us feel ashamed. To this, McDong replied, wherever our servant goes, referring to Undine, we must join her, watch over her, follow her. So watch yourself, behave, and don't overreact. From my own ears, I observed that the yagong or voice of Oknabanan and McDong did not always sound sonically distinct from each other. There were times when these seemed to blend as they did with the yagong of Undine. A few exchanges later, ex-Baila, now Pastor Jose, spoke in colloquial Manobo, this time without the tune, to ask Oknabanan what might be the future of humans considering the current hardships and uncertainties that they were now facing. I was told that this was a common human concern presented to spirits during rituals. Oknabanan responded, still singing, this conversation is cumbersome, and I am reluctant to answer your question. He then explained, no one accepts the law of God anymore. And in vernacular, he used the term ginoo, which is the term used for God. But in Agusan Manobo, it is Magbabaya who is the creator. But the two words ginoo and Magbabaya are used interchangeably. No one accepts the law of God anymore. That's why you shouldn't be surprised about the difficulties that people are now experiencing. At this point, a third Abyan, Tapnajanon, a woman spirit who also lived in the mountain forests and who was behind Undine's midwifery and healing, began to sing in Ayagong, not too different from Undine's lucid, mellow voice, at least from my own ears. Even our medium commits many mistakes. There is so much to be angry about her. Undine later explained to me that Tapnajanon had accused her of drinking too much, of not always complying with her mandatory ritual offerings, and of having children who had no understanding of tradition and who despised her as well as disagreed among themselves. Undine was also reprimanded for not owning a gong that was necessary for the rituals she officiated. Jose asked Oknabanan further about what else might humans do to save themselves if the helper spirits were now reluctant to address human concerns. To this, Oknabanan replied, that is very true. Spirits are now weak. We have become lowly and diminished in our capacity to help and to give assurances regarding the future of humans. It is because of people's mistakes that life has become so difficult. So be it. I will go home now. We, the ritual participants, then heard a loud heaving sound from Undine, as though she were either drowning or releasing something from deep inside her. I was later told that this sound, called heng hong, meant that the Abyan was leaving her body. But before Oknabanan could fully depart, Jose caught him in the nick of time to say, don't be in a hurry to go home. Here is a sick person whom we want to meet, referring to Saison. There is pain in his leg. Examine him and tell us the result of your investigation. We then heard a brief pause as if Oknabanan was determining what to sing next. He then launched into a melismatic passage, then proceeded with a good, that's the spirit song, this time addressing Tapnajanon, the healer Abyan. Translated to English by Jose. Take a look at this, Tapnajanon. You are the one to examine this one. Identify the spirit that may have been humiliated and hence caused this ailment, to ask what will happen to this sick person. We, the ritual participants, then saw an entranced Undine hold a peso coin with her right hand, a divining process called Beon, through Ba'on, Juan found out the cause of the illness, the possibility of healing, and the actions required for healing to take place. There are other kind of ways to find out about, you know, answers to questions like these, but Ba'on is one of them. Investigating further, Tapnajanan sang about traveling to Maibuyan, the city of the dead, a place on earth that could not be seen, to find out if Saison was meant to die or not. A few moments later, Tapnajanan sang, bringing forth some news. I see it now. The inflictor is Saison's father's companion. That means the father's Abyan. They are huddled together, sitting in the marsh. She continued, the source of the illness is the spirit that causes lightning to strike. That is what I see. The spirit that Tapnajanan was referring to was the Inajo, the spirit that is behind the wind, rain, thunder, and lightning. Tapnajanan further found out from her search that the reason the Inajo inflicted Saison with pain in his leg that made it difficult for him to walk and to move his arms was because of his disrespect towards his own father and his father's Abyan. Tapnajanan advised the ritual participants, tell the old man, that is Saison's father, to give assurance that the condition will not worsen. Addressing Saison, she sang, appreciate and ask forgiveness from your father. Also offer a chicken as payment for the return of your song. And to the inflictor, Tapnajanan sang, withdraw the illness. To all this, Oknabanan remarked, that is good. Everything you have said is true. Every word is correct. Continue the good conversation. Tapnajanan then instructed all the ritual participants, gather Saison's parents and the Abyan for the offering to seek their forgiveness. At this point, we heard Undine's heng hong again as she slowly regained her will. I was no longer in Barangay Panagangan when Saison's family performed the limpas buya, the fulfillment of their promise to make the required offerings in exchange for Saison's healing. When I next heard from Roblin, she told me that Saison could walk again. While I could partially make sense of what was going on in the good-good or the spirit singing through Undine based on her sonic and kinesthetic cues, as well as on Jose's and other elders' real-time linguistic translation of archaic Manobo ritual language to English, I knew I wasn't necessarily sharing in my fellow ritual participants' habitus of listening, which Judith Becker described as the overlapping, though not necessarily uniform interpretations, a pre-given set of expectations, a forced structure of understandings. For though I was born and raised in the same province of Agusan del Sur, my home only about a half-day travel away from Undines, and I had ritualist healers also among my maternal relations further north in Mindanao, I was not socialized in Bailan rituals and their sounds, having grown up in a heavily colonized lowland area where rituals hardly took place. I was therefore outside of this community of listeners. Because of my desire to know more about how Undine's good-good was heard by my fellow ritual participants, I arranged for Jose, Florencia, Bailan, Undine, Rob, and Robelin, and I to have a conversation about Paminog, or listening. Recalling his experience as a former Bailan who underwent mediumistic trances, Jose explained, the moment the Bailan is possessed by the Abyan, not one of her words can come out. She will no longer have her own ideas. And yet she remains awake, seated, seeing everything with a sight that pierces through things as if watching television. Her eyes, like a searchlight, can see beyond the screen into the very bright beyond. The Bailan sees all the spirits that her Abyan sees. And to this, Undine added, when I close my eyes, then things get even clearer and brighter. Jose added that the Bailan in such a state also hears the spirits very well by acquiring the Abyan's hearing. Reflecting on these statements, I thought that while Bailan Undine's words may no longer come out in the act of good, her ideas having taken over by the abyan or spirit helpers. Her yagong, the voice of her material body, continued to be heard, although altered by the act of merging with her abyan's voice. Yagong, in the context of good, did not totally eclipse the medium's voice, traces of which always remained a participant in the internal commingling of voices. About this, Jose Buen Consejo wrote, although personal tod'om is the voice of the person and stems from the singer's breath, it can in performance almost always merge with the external voice of the singer's spirit helper. This observation is of paramount importance because it means that voice in Manobo's song constitutes a medial subjectivity, neither an entirely atomistic self nor simply other. The affinity between what is inside and what is outside, a mimesis, resembles the song's messages, which are about movements of the living and the dead in the cosmos. To further elaborate on Buen Consejo's claim of songs or voice medial subjectivity, or what I refer to as the Bailan's voice's relationality or plural materiality, I relate two different ways in which spirit voices interact with the Bailan's voice, with implications on the yagong that physically issues from the Bailan's body at different times. Pigahadin puli, according to Undin, is when the abyan does not enter, but simply focuses on her, for example, to guide her on what to sing or say. Pigahadin puli comes close to what some have referred to as waking trance, that is, when the medium remains awake but receives guidance from external spirit agencies like deities and ancestors. In Undine's experience of Pigahadin Puli, she retains much of her yagong, but receives guidance on what to think or say. The other manner in which the abyan relates with Undine was through Yunaan, or Ogyunaan, Pigyunaan, Pigsedan, which Undine describes, signifies full entry of the abyan into my heart, causing me to tremble. This comes close to what had been described as mediumistic trance, or when the medium is entered into and controlled by another entity. Each time Undine was Pigyunaan, her yagong became dominated and upstaged by another, yet her voice was not totally eclipsed. Even if her mind was taken over, part of her embodied voice remained. As for Buen Consejo's claim of mimesis, or of a medium like Undine mimicking the voice of her abyan, this may take place only when the Bailan remained awake, as the case was with Pigahadin Puli, or when Undine actively mimicked the abyan who was guiding her. Such may not have been the case, however, when Undine was Pigyunaan, or entered into, that is, when she momentarily lost her ability to generate her own ideas, even as her yagong continued to be heard and to carry the abyan's voices. Another way of looking at this is to reverse the direction of mimesis. In the context of good, it was the abyan that partook of or mimicked Undine's yagong in order to gain audibility among human listeners. Mimesis between Bailan and Abyan, therefore, is a bilateral or multilateral process depending on the manner of spirit-human engagement. And like other forms of mimesis, the Abyan's imitation of Undine's voice was not total. Undine's yagong in the course of good was the negotiation of both the Bailan's and the Abyan's voices. Jose expounded further on the experience of listening among Bailans. Referring to Undine, he said, since she is now a Bailan, it is no longer necessary for her to call on her Abyan in order for them to come to her. Each time she sounds her yagong, her Abyan will hear it, and it is imperative that they come to her. It's like a telephone conversation in which someone from a different place or time gains immediate sonic presence. Even when it is not a Bailan who sings the tud'om, when this is sounded, it becomes heard loud and clear in the firmament, awakening the spirits that are familiar with them. Even if the voice originates from a recording, it is the same effect of attracting the spirit's attention. Manoba woman leader Robelin noted that it is not only the abyan or spirit that constantly hears the Bailan's yagong. The Bailan too constantly hears the abyan's yagong, not only during rituals but even outside of these. In addition, the Bailan constantly sees, smells, feels her or his abyan. Based on these discussions, paminog or listening for the Bailan, especially in the context of good-good, is a shared event participated in by human and spirit listeners. The Bailan in good-good acquired the breadth and depth of her Abyan's auditory function. She heard what the Abyan heard that was beyond the range of most human hearing. As far as the interpretive aspect of listening to the good-good is concerned, that is when the Bailan's mind was momentarily overtaken by the Abyan and was able to form its own ideas, it was the Abyan that heard the spirits that remained unheard in the good-good. In other words, the good-good, when it was going on, the human listeners could hear the Abyan's voices as these merged with the Bailan's voice. But there were voices that could not be heard, the voices of the other spirits that the Abyans were in conversation with. So there were multiple levels of listening, like the voices when Tapnajanan, for instance, went to the land of the dead to ask about what will happen to the sick person. There was a conversation that happened there, but which the ritual participants could not hear. As for the other ritual participants, especially those who understood archaic ritual language, they were the ones who interpreted the Abyan's messages to those who did not understand them, including the Bailan as soon as she regained consciousness. Because while this whole thing was going on, the Bailan could not really, you know, she did not really actively hear with her own ears because this was taken over by those of the spirits. But when she gained her consciousness, then it was the other ritual participants who explained to her, this was what the spirit said. Here is an auditory model of constant movement, shifts, and overlaps, not only by one auditor, but among different participating auditors within and outside the Bailan's ears. The overlapping processes of paminog, or listening, as well as yagong, or voice, in good-good, both arise from a keen sense of plural human and non-human materialities that may not, however, be construed as annulling the identity of each participating entity. This is especially so with the medium's yagong that becomes primarily responsible for unseen spirits to be heard. Of Abyans or spirit guides and helpers, ex-Bailan Jose explained, every Abyan has an individual body that is not seen and is so light, not seen by most people, and is so light, it can travel with the wind and penetrate through walls as well as human body parts. It is a body that takes on a gender and an age that help determine the quality of its yagong or voice as well as its bodily comportment during good-good. But it is a body that neither gets born nor grows old nor dies. While each Abyan's body has an original form, for example, resembling a human, it is able to shape-shift into any other animate being. And while an Abyan has an original voice, it has the capability to change that voice into that of a child or an elderly person or a man or a woman, regardless of who the medium is. The Abyan's body could not be seen by most people, nor touched except by those who themselves have Abyan. Thus, Undine refers to the Abyan as tao, like or persons, just like us. They are tao, who are unseen by most people, she said. They, however, can be heard by most ordinary people, most ordinary humans like ourselves, through the mediation of the Bailan's voice in the course of good-good. Not only do Undine's Abyan have bodies that are not seen but by most, but I heard, They are in place in specific regions of the Manobo universe. My grandmother, Bikdong, for example, Undine explained, the highest Bailan during her time, and now my principal, Abian, moved residence upon her death to Maibuyan, the city of the dead, a place on earth that could not be seen, from where she travels back at will to the land of the living to assist us with our needs. My second Abian Oknabanan, the owner of my grandmother's stud or song, and now mine, is a Teabobong, or a nature-dwelling spirit who lives in Kabubungan, or mountains and forests. Whenever we sing and dance for Usiba, that is for the purpose of entertainment or education, just like what we're doing right now, he may be told that there is no need to come. But sometimes he comes anyway to participate because as a Manod Omai, or a Tudom singer, he enjoys performing. My third Abian Tapnajanon, the power behind my hilot or healing through touch and child delivery, is a woman Teabobong who also lives in Kabobongan. In addition to these three Abian, I have a fourth, according to Undin, Batahanon Dangupanon, that lives in Inugduhan, a place between heaven and earth. It is the custodian of the wind, rain, thunder, and lightning, and causes rain to pour and the river to rise. It also causes my weight, according to Undine, to be so light, so that like my grandmother before me, I can dance on water and not drown. With these descriptions of Undine's Abian's emplacements, Undine alluded to the different types of Abian, those from one's ancestry, those that lived in one's own land, and those that have wider jurisdictions, like the wind, rain, lightning, and thunder, all of which operate under Magbabaja, or the creator, the cause of all things. Besides being in place, Undine's Abian have histories, at least in relation to humans. Undine, for example, observed that in the olden days, there was no need to see the doctor at all. The Abian would always come and heal the sick, even if it's just diarrhea. Without pills and capsules, one found relief. I would just hold the child when the Abian was inside me, according to Undine, and immediately the child would get well. I myself never consulted a doctor, she said. To this, my other research guide, Pastor Florencia Havana, added about her husband. Even Pastor Jose never consulted a doctor when he was still a Bailan. The Abian was always there to help. But the Abian are different now, Undine lamented. They may still help, but they are not as powerful as they were before. Florencia attributes the diminishing of the Abian's powers to the many obstacles that now beset them. Long ago, Florencia said, the Abian used to have no competition or rival for the people's devotion. But now there is religion, as well as Western medicine in the form of pills and capsules that is being promoted by both the government and the missionaries. As a result, few people now continue to invoke the Abian. And while all that the Abian wanted was to do was to assist humans in peace, there are too many forces that are against them now. To this, Bailan Undine added, many have departed. Many of the Abian have departed crying, leaving the human world behind for a place far away. The biggest change, Florencia added, has been that many of the Abian's followers have now embraced Christianity because the Spirit of God is also real. They have begun to attend church, listen to sermons, read the Bible, and sing Christian songs. These are the very same people, Undine observed, who have turned to cursing the spirits, shaming them, casting them away, insulting them. That is why many of them are no longer around, she said. My Abian have remained only because I have stayed devoted to them and continue to call on them, she added. There is a lot more to say about the Abian and the Bailan and how they come together in the Yagong and Paminog of the Manobo, Abian like Undine. But suffice it to say for now that the permeability and relationality of the body, voice, and listening among indigenous Filipinos like Undine have not been fully suppressed by forces that have attended attempted to tear asunder ties that have bound ancestor, land, and humans since time immemorial. In Bailan Undin's world of plural and overlapping materialities that converged in her Yagong and Paminog, voice and audition were relational, overlapping, and dynamic, constituted by the comings and goings of different voices and hearings. The Yagong and Paminog that Undin acquired in the process of Gudgud gained temporary prominence over her own as her sonic and linguistic presence and interpretive ability weakened, but was not fully eclipsed. This weakness was also temporary and applied only within the time frame of Gudgud, up until Undin's henghong, when we, the ritual participants, heard the sonic signs of the visiting voice's departure and release. With Undin's yagong remaining a participant in the layers of voices within her own, and with Undin's paminog or participating in the layers of listenings within her own, we find a relationality that does not annul identity. As for Undine's healing, this took the form of restoring Saison's respectful relationship with his own father, and in effect, with his father's Abian, a relationship that was disrupted when, due to external influences and pressures, Saison took to actively insulting his father and his father's Abian. Here is a conception of health that, according to F. Landa Hokano, results in the harmonious relationships between the individual and its relationships with other humans, the land, and spirits. I cite Hokano in saying that efforts have to be exerted to maintain these harmonious relations, or maladjustments may follow. Should problems occur, however, certain culturally valid medication is required to rectify the error. This is one reason why prayers and rituals are effective therapeutic instruments, according to Hokano. In this way, patients are reintegrated into normal social status in the community. The spirit's reprimand in the form of illness was overturned after Saison and his family listened to the Gudgud of Undin and her spirit helpers as these traced the cause of the illness and prescribed the specific change in behavior and the ritual required to bring about healing. At this point, I would like to ask the question, is yagongs or voices permeability and plurality applicable only to a Bailan like Undin? What about people like ourselves who may not even believe in spirits, let alone think of ourselves as entered by these spirits? Martin Daughtry wrote something that may partly address this concern. He wrote, "A voice as constructed in part through our mimetic, dialectic, dialogic, and polyphonic relationships with the voices that surround us from birth. Voice is not the essence of a unitary self, but an instrument through which our different personalities, our many overlapping selves, are projected out into the world." If we take Daughtry's prescription for now, and if I sing a tud-om is song, right? Good is when it's the spirit singing. So coming from the same province, I will share with you a tud-om that was taught to me. Now jambu kanu marungu ngohang Tanda kanada jawag suwairuwag kaliruku ngo ngo hang panahalit ko joon katayun ukatag nuiku. Oh,
jon kantayu ukata doi ku no So the tud om that you heard, that we heard, issued from my own somatic and material presence, my voice. But is that all? Might that voice also bear the traces of voices, for instance, of my mother, my father, my significant others, school teachers, chant mentors, like the Babaylan, colonial and global experiences, as well as efforts to reclaim ancestral voices against continuing campaigns to silence them. With these questions, I leave you to ponder and listen to each of your voices, including those voices that you may not always hear or recognize, or that you perhaps dismiss or silence, but that in some way are part of your own. Thank you all for listening. Salama.
Thank you very much, Grace, for this beautiful presentation and the beautiful voice. It reminds me in China, too, as I talked with you last time, the shaman tradition was very, very important. And to me, I think to some extent, you know, in China, the shamanistic culture was the beginning of Chinese culture. The word for shaman in Chinese related to doctor, to diviner, and also to the mediator between heaven and the earth, between human beings. And also, but in China today, you know, the shamans, they are not legal, and the government didn't like them. And they have to practice shamanistic healing in a very secret way. And in the village where I was born, my mother used to invite a shaman to treat her illness. She was afraid that she may have cancer. And so this shaman came through singing and dancing, and she told my mother that she didn't have it. And later on, my mother went to the hospital, and the doctor told her that she didn't have cancer. And this practice was more than 30 years ago, but today it is legally forbidden. So I wonder, what is the social or legal status of shamans here in your country? And what might be the kind of psychological or social factors that make them want to be shamans, want to be shaman healers? And this is my question. Thank you.
Thank you, Dong. Thank you all. First of all, I want to say that when I give these talks, usually, if possible, I want a shaman, a Babaylan, with me, is to answer questions that the Babaylan should say, you know, from her own voice. But yes, in the Philippines, but the Babaylan, you know, to use a general term, are also not legal. There have been moves by the government to kind of give legal status to herbalists and those who do the massage, the traditional massage we call hilot, but ritualists are still excluded. So, you know, the campaign to acknowledge all of our healers, you know, regardless of the modality, after all, they still continue to heal, and people still go to them, because not all illnesses can be treated with the hospital. You know, it depends on what the cause of the illness is. The campaigns continue to kind of recognize, give due recognition to the Babaylan.
Your other question is the what the traits of a person usually is. First of all, in our communities, hardly anyone would like to become a babaylan. Not because it's, you know, well, some say because it's a bad thing, those who have taken that stance because they have been taught to, you know, abandon and just leave that tradition behind. But people know how hard the life of a babaylan is. Nobody will want to do it. You know, you anytime you get called, you go. You know, and so the type of person that they say is usually called, first of all, you have to be, you know, a kind and gentle soul, a very giving. You give the last whatever, you know, whatever it is you have, you give it to whoever needs it. You know, they say another reason why people don't want to be a babaylan, because babaylans are poor, because they cannot keep, you know, things to themselves. They give it to whoever needs. And others say, you know, babaylans have to be that, but also they have to be conscientious about their obligations to the spirit world, to be able to do the rituals, you know, as needed. And some say they have to have good voice to speak and to sing and to carry the voice of spirit. So, yeah. Did I answer your question somehow? Thank you. Yes. They are not recognized as doctors, as healers. They are often referred to as quack doctors, and they have no legal status. But still, you know, people know that even if they are marginalized in that way, they perform a very important function. As I said, there are illnesses that the doctors will not be able to understand. They will go to the hospital first, get themselves diagnosed, and maybe there's nothing that is found out of their conditions, and so they return to the babaylan to see if there's anything that the babaylan can do. Yeah, but there are, you know, there are times, I've heard an uncle of mine who also heals, there are times when the person is in the hospital, a sick person in the hospital would invite him to go to the hospital, but quietly. Yeah. Yes. Did I answer your question, Anne? Thank you.
Thank you so much for the beautiful presentation and extraordinary song. Thank you. I'm very, very struck by the contrast in terms of legality between China and Philippines and Peru, where I work. And I have been participating in ceremonies for over 20 years. And it's strange because the history is the same. The conquistadores and the church totally persecuted and prohibited. And yes, they had laws.
Mm-hmm.
And the laws are apparently still in the books, but they cannot, it's legal. Apparently once the Minister of Health tried to outlaw ayahuasca, which is one of the major plant brew used in Amazonian shamanism. There's three traditions, coastal, highlands, and Amazon. And it lasted 2 weeks. There was a revolution in the country. And furthermore, it's now becoming wildly sought after by urbanites in Latin America and people from the north, which in itself is creating a particular problem of charlatans just to make money. So now you have to be very careful. If you go on the Amazon, on the internet, looking for Amazonian shamanism, there'd be so many things, and it's very dangerous to go blindly. So that contrast is, you know, what is it that brought that about is amazing. But what I just wanted quickly to share is that I collaborate with a center that's very close to where mine is in the high Amazon that was founded 23 years ago by a French doctor who had apprenticed with all the most well-known local shamans for 6 years. And the spirits told him that he needed to give back by treating drug addiction. It was a center of the drug trade with cocaine. So this doctor is an extraordinary shaman himself and is very successful. And he works with others, and so he uses traditional medicine augmented by transpersonal or Jungian therapy to treat drug addicts who now come from all over the world, actually. And so it's very interesting because he's trained in France as an MD in, you know, the modernist. And he knows, and he can diagnose, under my eyes I've seen it, he's healed me. And he says he can, through, you know, the local manner of doing it, he knows if a spirit has come into your body and is creating havoc. So there's absolutely no question for him. And he says that modernity willfully kind of closes its eyes to this reality. And lastly, I just want to mention something that I thought I would never witness in my life. I have a colleague at Mount Holyoke College. I taught at Smith College. She's a political scientist. And totally respected. She was a dean of the college for over 10 years. She's just published a book this spring that the subtitle is Teachings from Manjushri, a Tibetan bodhisattva, who just came, she heard, and then it went on for years, and he told her things, and he said, you should write it down, and she put it down, and said, you should publish, and she's published it. So, and this, you know, things seem to be shifting, both in the bastion of modernity, if you will, Western Academy, and with people, hordes of people going to the Amazon for shamanic healing. And I'm curious to see how you hear that.
Yes, thank you for that. What's going on right now is there is a growing fascination among, as I mentioned earlier, the intellectual elite who are, you know, becoming interested in the Babaylan. So for a long time, there has been a separation, you know, the elite people reading only the history books, you know, first written by the colonizers who claim that the Babaylans have disappeared. You know, so they believe that, and now they want to embody the Babaylan. And so that is also where my intervention is, because I personally know Babaylan. So my work now is to let the two groups meet and to inform each other for them to, because the middle class, you know, intellectuals, they are well-meaning, but yeah, you have to, this is not just discourse, this is embodied practice. So if they're serious about this, then they have to meet the practitioners, they have to learn to see if it's even something that they would like to do. Yes, as far as back to legality, yes, our traditional midwives are now being persecuted. if they practice, they have to be fined, and the pregnant woman who gives birth is also fined. So, you know, this is really what's going on. And midwifery, you know, that kind of practice is part of the Babaylan's function.
Yeah, I had a quick question. I'm curious to know how the practitioner, the person who feels called to be a healer, receives recognition or qualifies as such, and if there are lineages, and if the teacher-student relationship is central to their ultimately being acknowledged as healers, or to what extent it's formalized, to what extent it's informal.
Okay, thank you. In the Philippines, there are two major ways that one becomes a Babaylan. The first is through lineage. And you learn in your family, just assisting from the very beginning, and you know, and when you're like what happened to Undine, when her grandmother passed away, her grandmother started coming to her, you know, taking her grandmother's spirits to be part of her, you know, team. The other way is even people without the lineage, they get chosen by the spirits, so they might start having dreams, they might get sick. This is the usual story. There is a ritual to kind of mark the acceptance. You might butcher an animal to kind of feed those who are wanting to come to you. That is the extent of the formality, but then you start healing your family, and people will hear about it. And if you are effective, then they will start coming to you and asking you. You know, it's not for you to kind of advertise that you are one. The Yaba Bailans I know are very quiet people, very humble. You know, it's not to brag about.
Thank you, Grace, for a great presentation. Two things you mentioned that were really interesting. One of the first things you said was that you're interested in intervening in these like discourses that are talking about this kind of fossilized notion or idealized notion of the Babaylans, as well as at the end you mentioned that the spirits are kind of having competition because of Christianity and all these kinds of, I guess, different forms of modernities and technologies. And I was interested in if you'd noticed any kind of changes in the conception of the spirit world that reflect changes in the kind of contemporary world that they're living in. So for example, thinking about technologies that mediate voice or expand voice, like voice recording, we can like use cell phones, different things like that. Kind of do those things get also reflected in the spirit world and in the ways in which they're conceiving of the spirit world right now?
Thank you for that. There are different Babaylans I've encountered. Their spirits would have different responses to technology. One Babaylan I met, she said, okay, yeah, you can record. But then when I was recording, what I thought it was the spirit that spoke through him. This was a male Babaylan, and who said, stop. And so I stopped. But there are others who, you know, I would ask permission if I can photograph, and they would say, only camera, only photography, no video. So they demand that you know, they be presented, you know, the most cutting-edge technology. Some, you know, just this summer, I asked to take photos of a particular, you know, seance. And when the spirit has already descended, I stopped the camera out of respect. After the whole thing, they told me, why did you stop? That was the most important part of all. You know, so it's really different responses. You just have to really play it by ear. But a lot of them want even, you know, in my book, there is a CD, and the last minute I said, I don't want, maybe I shouldn't do this, it's not right, you know, and I went back to, you know, my interlocutors, I said, maybe I don't want to publish the sonic, you know, the audio files. And they said, no, you have to put it out there. They have to be heard. They have to be listened to. So, yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
In terms of voice and your concluding invitation for being with voices of many kinds, your as well as the spirit and the plural. Now, what is the journey of these multiple voices at work? And for example, the way it works out, song is one manifestation. But if, for example, there is the manifestation of these voices in terms of poetry, and then, you know, if the spirit voice is not just the reproduction of existing language, then what is the implication of the spirit voice in terms of reconstitution of the language and maybe creation of a different kind of language, maybe a word which is a different potency, a healing power? So the second query is that the Babylons, what is the relational field of the Babylons? You know, what is the nature of community among them, the interaction between them?
Thank you. I will respond to the first one first. The first one was a little more complicated. The Babylons, it's not a centralized, there is no centralized governing powers. You know, it's each community will have a family that has the lineage of the Babylon. They don't necessarily know each other, and they call different ancestors. They call different spirits, depending on where they are, different histories. But you see a common thread in their practices, as well as differences, of course. So no, they're not, you know, it's only probably recently with the intervention of, you know, people like myself, humbly, that they are starting to meet, some of them. And we did this just this summer, and they were happy to meet with each other, just to compare, you know, to just, you know, they were sharing their spirits, introducing one spirit to the other. That was for them. This was a gathering of a number of Babylon and, you know, a number of people like myself, you know, the younger generation. So for us, we were happy to meet the Babylons, but for the Babylons, they were happy to meet each other. And the first question, reconstitution of language, I didn't quite get it. Can you simplify it, please? Thank you.
No, language, you know, any language and theory of language is very much in terms of social practice. Now, these women, they live in a world of language, you know, which is a social norm. But when you hear the voice of the spirit, when the spirit comes through you, then it is not just the reproduction of the existing social language. So, you know, what is the implication of that for rethinking language and reconstituting language? Maybe a new language, a new word emerges, poetry, and, you know, in literary work it happens.
Okay. The way I would answer that probably is it's the other way around. The language of the Agusan Manobo comes from the language of spirit. It's not the Agusan Manobo, it's not the spirits reproducing the language of humans. It's the humans reproducing the language of spirits. Of course, it's a dynamic there, you know, and there are the language of the Agus and Manobo are changing because of history, because of the different ethno-linguistic groups they are encountering. But then it seems that the language of spirit has that archaic quality. You know, that's why one needs interpreters like the elders, because the younger people no longer really understand what the spirits are saying. But also, it's not just the language, the language's referential meanings that are important here. It is the sound itself, and it is important. You know, if you become a Babaylan, according to the Babaylans I have met, you have to learn how to not just speak the words, but to sing it in a way that is recognizable to the spirits. It's not enough to, because to the spirits, talking is sung. Talking is singing in the same way that to these spirits, walking is dancing. I hope somehow I answered your question.
I think you've answered a lot of questions. Thank you so much for sharing your amazing voice.